There's movement at the stations, with positions being shifted and shored up on the 360 agenda. The Players Association boss takes the leap to clubland as Matt Finnis accepts the challenge at the Saints. We reflect on the NAB challenge, the best and the worst, the formats and the hints of what's to come. And Players Night still features a hawk and a bulldog. Jordan Lewis is in to join Bob Murphy. I'm Jared Waitley, he's Mark Robinson. This is Footy from All Angles. Robbo, anyone can do one show. It feels very real tonight.
Oh, last night was intense. For the first night of the year, I went home and I thought, God, if they're all like this for the rest of the year, we're in trouble. But Deep Breath Tuesday, it'll survive this year, no doubt. I love that coin.
And Geordie Lewis?
Let's be honest, I don't know if he's watching. He's out in the green room, whatever we call it. He's out there eating food. He was the unsociable hawk. Remember?
It does seem to me that we have a good one to sit next to you.
Oh, I really enjoy his foot. You know why? I say this all the time, but I like players who know what they're going to do when they go out in the park. And Dennis Pagan said it about Glenn Archer. He already decides, the intent's already decided before he walks on. Jordan Lewis is the kind of guy who lives and dies for his Hawthorn jumper. One of the greatest pieces of courage I've ever seen was when he went after that ball in the middle of the ground and just got absolutely smackerooed and got knocked out. He tried to get up and play again. You know, he's a tremendous courage. He probably may even be the next Hawthorn captain, who knows?
Righto.
You like him?
Yeah, I do. I'm looking forward to having him as part of it. A summer matinee. Not related to footy, given that there really wasn't time for small talk last night. So, a bit of small talk tonight.
I bought a dog.
Oh!
Jared, I bought a dog.
Got into the family business, Robbo.
Why? What's that mean?
Well, you're not a sole occupant anymore.
There he is. I might bring him in one night.
What's his name?
His name's Tiger. Well, I've changed his name to you little shit. Because when I first got him, he was cute and cuddly and a few accidents. Now I think he's doing it intentionally. He's only 12 weeks. My love for him's not the same, but I do now have an appreciation what it's like to have a child.
Right.
I don't think you can rub the child's nose in his puddles if you do. I have to teach him somehow, Jared. Not the way in the house.
Have you taken advice on what the best way to teach him might be? Or are you just sort of going on animal instinct, shall we say?
Just winging it, Jared.
No, Tiger.
I'll bring him in one night. He'll run rampant around here, but he's not bad.
I can already sense the Waitley house being a rescue for Tiger in about round 13.
What was your summer highlight?
Well, you brought the dog, so I'll bring my little fella. I've had the summer with the kids, which has been great.
I was part of it. I was here when it was born.
So Benj has picked up. Look, I heard LeBron James shot 61 today.
He did?
I just say, eat your heart out, LeBron. He's just obsessed with balls.
That is pretty simple sports skill, but I still would say that he got it from his mum.
Balance is not everything. 17 months?
How good's that?
So he just spends hour upon hour just shooting these hoops.
Good bloody mat of hair there too.
Yeah. Blonde surfy hair. He doesn't get that from me. In fact, he might be leading in our household for male hair at the moment. It's all going one way.
That's good footage,
okay,
mate.
Let's get into the agenda. Tonight, the AFL's taken a step towards its goal of equalisation at the end of a day-long meeting of the presidents and the chief executives in Adelaide. Basically, a 10-point plan has been released with what has been agreed. There are three key elements to this, so we'll cherry-pick and interpret them for you. The first is that from here on, the clubs need the capacity to be able to pay 100% of the salary cap. So that lifts the base. At the other end, there needs to be a mechanism to control growth in non-player football payments. And that was point four. And then point five immediately underneath was the aspiration to move towards a pure draft and a salary cap. So you can interpret that as lifting the base so that every team can pay 100%, which is absolutely essential. The cap that's coming and the tax on revenue on the football spend, where if you exceed the cap, you'll pay 50 cents in the dollar or some such. That's to be agreed
upon. For those who follow some American sport in the NBA, they call it a luxury tax.
Mm-hmm. and then the idea of the pure draft and salary cap, which is utterly essential, is the removal of cost of living and veterans and all the little compromises that have been made across the years to what would be actual equalisation.
That's a move to fix that. That won't be happening totally this year. That'll be balanced out, I would imagine, over the next 2 or 3 years, because clubs who have got players in their veterans allowance, they just can't be sort of snapped on this as a decision. They've got to work out their own total player payments. I don't think we'll ever get to a pure draft. We will, but not in the foreseeable future. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're propping up teams such as GWS and Gold Coast. I just don't think that the AFL is ready to say, righto, GWS, you're on your own 2 feet. Seriously, Benjamin's walking better than what GWS is in the AFL competition.
Now, the showstopper in what came this afternoon was deep down on page 3, where it was revealed what Andrew Demetriou's salary as the chief executive of the AFL was last year. It was $1.47 million. Then you add on the bonuses to $1.8 million. And then the long-term incentive bonus kicked in of a further $2 million. So overall, Andrew Demetriou, and I can see this on the back page of tomorrow's paper, took home $3.8 million. Last year.
In anyone's language, right? Not even regarding how well this competition is going financially, Andrew Demetriou, or the CEO of the AFL, does not deserve to earn $3.8 million. That's just a figure. I mean, I remember the backlash when he got paid 2.2. Now, this has only happened recently, so this will be discussed over the next 24 hours, absolutely. How a person can be on a base salary of $1.7 million and get a bonuses totalling $1.8 million. People accuse the AFL executive, rightly or wrongly, accuse the executive of making decisions on a financial basis, because on that financial basis and increased crowds and stuff, that they get their bonuses. So that's going to add absolutely fuel to that debate. What's your immediate reaction?
Well, because it is skewed. The $2 million bonus relied on outcomes over the last 4 years, but it also relied on a service period, I think, of 10 years in the job, which goes past.
Where else does that happen? Did you get a bonus at the ABC?
I certainly didn't get a bonus
at the Herald Sun.
Yeah, I don't think we're probably the right points of comparison. I suspect in corporate life that is not outside the realms.
Okay, but this is devil's advocate. You reckon I'll be prerogative? I'm not. Devil's advocate. This is the club's money, okay? The competition's money. So when the commission draws up these contracts, do they send out their contract to all the clubs to say, well, here you go, this is what we're paying Andrew, and we're going to give him all these bonuses, and we're going to give him a long-term bonus? Are clubs aware of that, or do they arrive in Adelaide like they did today for the presidents and the CEO's meetings with the AFL and say, by the way, Andrew got $3.8 million? Is it right that the competition's money, the club's money, is given to Andrew $2 million for doing a pretty good job, and you've been here for 10 years, you know, well done, here's $2 million?
It's probably a bit more than that.
Well, tell me what more it is. I'm just trying to keep it straight down the barrel.
Yeah,
you tell me.
Yeah.
Oh, no, tell me.
Well,
it would be
growing the game. It would be the revenue to the game. So, and I would take a stab that in corporate Australia, is once you meet certain benchmarks, the triggers.
Yeah, but this is where everyone gets upset, mate. Yeah. We get upset with the chief executive of Commonwealth Bank. Oh, this is terrible. We're only making $484 billion. And everyone goes, oh, here's your bonus. I mean, it's not right, mate. Society gets a little bit upset with the haves and haves not, and sometimes the abuse of the haves and haves not. I would argue that Andrew doesn't need $2 million for long service, and you're doing a good job. He's already getting them with their bonus. If you said to me, without the $2 million, Andrew took home
1.8. So 1.4
and 1.8 is 3.2. I reckon that's too much, isn't it?
It's a conversation starter, that's for sure. It does make the job extremely sought after, I would have thought, and the conversation did move there today. And Gillon McLaughlin, this is the brilliance of cartoons.
This is Mark Knight, the Herald Sun. He is just absolutely fantastic.
As my reign comes to an end, the AFL will search the four corners of the globe in a bid to find a successor. Nice. That was the best way to put it. And then you couple it up with Gills to lose. Clubs, rivals, back number three, McLaughlin, to replace Dimitri.
All seriously, there was an absolute override of support for Gill and McLaughlin. Okay.
And if we wanted to pin that down to one, James Brayshaw, the North Melbourne chairman, his view was just do it now.
I wonder why you'd spend 7 years grooming someone and spend a lot of time keeping him away from the NRL, not to give him the job when it comes up. I hear the whole governance argument, and I hear the, go and get an external firm and all the rest of it. But when you've got such a high quality candidate sitting there, why would you bother with any of that? Just appoint him. I think he's outstanding, Gil. I think he's got an enormous amount to offer the organisation. He understands it back to front. As I say, been groomed for the role, got great respect, clubland, certainly at our footy club. So I'm just not really sure why you'd go through a process when you don't have to.
Do you think that's representative of a widespread view?
No, I don't know. I heard Eddie Maguire disagree with that, and I've heard James Brayshaw speak. If it is Gil McLaughlin and they're confident in him, I'm probably more in James Brayshaw's camp. Why waste more money? If the guy is there and the commission wants him and the clubs are happy with him and he knows what to do, he's clearly an intelligent man.
Yep.
Clearly he knows the workings of the AFL, and he also knows the workings of really important stuff like the media rights, which he covers off every time it comes up. I have no problem. You know what I do? I don't want us to be talking about who's the next CEO in September next year.
Yeah.
Just a distraction.
I doubt that would be happening. But I think you just have to check. And I think it actually further validates the choice that you make.
How do you check?
You have to just shake the trees and see who's
available. So you've got to put an advert out there.
No, I wouldn't have thought so.
So
I wouldn't have thought that's
cold
how
cool.
They're headhunting cold call.
Cold call. G'day. Hello. We've got 3.8 million.
3.8 million. Yeah. You get a few guesses. another position has fallen into place. The AFLPA Chief Executive Matt Finnis is going to leave the player's body and head to St Kilda to take on the challenge there. And it is a not insignificant challenge. This was how he framed it this afternoon.
After 9 years at the PA, I'm really proud of what it is we've achieved in the context of being able to take on a next challenge for me professionally. To be able to do that within the game that I love is something which appealed to me. When it became apparent that that St Kilda were willing to wait for me to finish the work that I've got my eye on here at the moment, opened, I guess, the way for me to start to explore that opportunity.
Good get for the Saints?
Again, I just spoke about Gil McLaughlin. Matthew Finnis, he knows a lot about AFL. He knows a lot about players. He appreciates that. I know, Matty, I've spoken to him a lot of times. Is he dynamic enough? I don't know how important that is as a CEO. I think the most important role as a CEO is to put in good culture, have really strong values in rebuilding this football club, and I've got no doubt. The funny thing about it, and I've touched on this in tomorrow's Herald Sun, we rang Matthew Finnis last week and put the fact that he will be appointed St Kilda CEO.
And?
Then he talks about integrity and values in ethics in the last 2 days about the Herald Sun. Anyway.
You keep that to the paper, shall we?
We'll talk about that tomorrow night.
One other position. Kevin Bartlett's tenure, a 20-year tenure on the Laws of the Game Committee, has come to an end. He's been the most probably influential, certainly the most outspoken representative of that panel, which has made such a mark on the game in recent years. And this afternoon, he was on his own station, SEN, to speak about his departure.
My advice would be, do what's best for the game. Don't do what's best for an individual, what's best for a coach. Don't do what's best for a faction group. Do what's best for the game of Australian rules football. I looked at the game and I thought it's in fantastic shape. The laws are great. I've saved the game. So time to move on.
I reckon he's being nice there, KB. I think there's been a bit of a falling out. I think he's a bit disappointed in aspects of the AFL. And that's one of the reasons he pulled out. And there's no point going kicking and screaming and whacking. He's been fantastic for the rules of the game. Fantastic. A lot of respect around the competition. 20 years, the argument is, 20 years is probably enough. you know, surely. Game changes, get new blood on. I think it's been a, not a bad swap. John Worsfold comes on, a recent coach. I think that's a terrific appointment. But there's always a little bit of darkness.
Kevin doesn't mince his words, so I'm sure we'll find out tomorrow morning.
I hope so.
Okay, we're just going to have a look through some of the key issues that have shaped things on the way to 2014. The issues between when we were last on and the resumption of things here. Some of them are still relevant. Some of them still seep through to the headlines right now. So against the hourglass, Robbo, with a couple of minutes per topic. The first here, is re-signing Nathan Buckley a smart play? A two-year extension at the Pies?
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely a smart thing to do. There's not much more I can say. He had 2 years to work in what we would call a difficult transition. Nathan Buckley would not call it a difficult transition. We would. He's shaping the team and the values how he wants them. He needs time to do that. I think it's a terrific re-signing. Do you agree?
When all of your decision-making is geared around this period of time we're talking about, 2015 and 2016, then the man who's the architect and the brains behind it, he simply has to see it through.
Yeah.
So rather than, you could wait till some stage during this year, but it's no doubt it's going to happen. So, and it's the conversation that spins around the outside sometimes that wouldn't change the thinking of the club, but certainly would change the perception of what's going on. If Collingwood starts poorly, for instance.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
So when you know the course of action, and it's a strong, sensible course of action, just move. And so the timings are utterly perfect as well to do it at your season launch. You've committed the future into Buckley's hands, which you did at the time of the handover.
Yep.
He's now made all of the change that he both forecast and committed to, and now he's going to see it through to wherever that logical conclusion is. But judgment time for Collingwood sits about there.
Yeah, it does. Well, yeah, and again, outside, we think that, but Nathan Buckley's a bit more bullish about his list. I like the fact he's introduced a really good word to football, evolution.
Mm-hmm.
I like it when people introduce new words to football.
He spoke evolution and culture, and he's got an extension. Okay, we'll flip over to topic number two.
I'll ask it.
All right.
Did the Saints make the right call on Scott Watters?
Yes, they did. You would say, in hindsight, they made it too late. As if that was their course of action, then going through the whole trading period and the lift shaping period before removing the coach and going to fresh hands. That's, you know, they were probably conservative at a time when it was obviously a flashpoint within St Kilda, certainly at board level, and it seeped through all the different layers of the club. I think they initially shirked making the decision and then realised that it was inevitable. So I do think, you know, from Alan Richardson's point of view, is he starts a year behind because he didn't get to make those decisions on the shape of things. And, you know, to look at them now is to realise how far back they're going to be coming from.
But that wasn't Scott Watters' fault. Scott Watters took over a team coached by Ross Lyon, who coached for the Now, didn't probably have the depth, the kids, so he didn't play them, so he kept on playing the men. They were bereft of kids. And the middle group, if you get a list manager in here, say Terry Wallace was in here, or a champion data saying, let's assess this list. That list was shot. They had too many holes. So Watters is trying to build that list. My understanding of why Scotty is gone, and he would probably disagree with this, but Scotty was gone because Scotty's power, which he thought was absolute, wasn't quite at the level that he thought. Now, he would say yes to some things and then perhaps not say yes when he was elsewhere. He wanted to do things, a lot of it his ways, which a coach wants to do. But in promising to do something with the board and Chris Palkin and footy ops and all that sort of stuff, they thought that he didn't quite commit to that.
Are you a yes or a no on the bald proposition there? Did they make the right call?
I'll pass on it.
Oh, pass!
Well, I wasn't in there.
Pass on anything.
I wasn't in the club.
No, it's an opinion. Anyway, we're
no. Okay, no, no, no.
Are the Suns better off without Campbell Brown?
No.
No, I'm in the no camp here.
No.
But they had to do what they did, I think.
This looks terrible. This happens everywhere around the world, but it looks terrible. They're obviously razzed up. They've had a few drinks. These things happen, Jared. I know they don't happen in your life, but these things do happen amongst friends. But he'd run out of chances. We always say it. If that was a once-off, we'd say, Campbell, mate, pull your head in. But when it's happened too many times, you say, Campbell, I'm sorry, mate. We've got to do this for the good of our club. We're going to have to cut you. Now, it ended okay. Campbell was pretty happy to be in Gold Coast. The club said, sorry, mate, we've got to go. You've been fantastic. So it departed okay from what I know. What they're going to miss, and it's an aspect of footy that's sometimes forgotten because it's so fast and transitional and interchange rotations of people are in and people out. Sometimes your football clubs, not sometimes, always football clubs need players that make other players feel a little bit better about themselves, because that generates confidence and it generates sort of quick thinking. They don't have to second think anything. And Campbell Brown was one of those guys. He sat in half forward flank. And when Bunnell come down and the young boys come down, rest in midfield, they know that Campbell had their back.
Yep.
And that's a very, very important aspect of footy.
Yeah. So they're not better off, but it was the essential thing to do.
Yep.
Okay. And so as we flip
ask me this.
Here, is Jake King really a problem?
No.
No. We found vague accord anyway.
Scotty Waters, but that's 50-50, you know, you could go anyway. No, Jake King is not a problem. And I think if we get to a stage in life where an authority other than the police are telling you who you can hang around with, and they probably even wouldn't listen to the police if they're your great friend, but you've got a sporting organisation telling you who you can or can't hang around with, I think that's not right. I think that's an invasion of civil rights. That said, Jake has to be careful about what he does. Don't go for a pizza down Lygon Street and catch up with Mick Gatto. I don't think that would be a very, very good situation. But if you're going to hang around with a mate, just do it privately.
Yeah.
That's all. Do it privately, because, Jake, you have got a responsibility to your football club as well.
Yeah. So there are degrees here. Clearly, taking him to the rooms is not, that's not appropriate.
No, that's not appropriate.
And
running out through the banner with him was a good idea either.
But you're entitled, you have to do something wrong, I think, to earn the level of scrutiny and judgment that's been applied to this
judgment,
and demand.
The judgment. I think the judgment was over the top. And that's why I said to Andrew Demetrio last night, so say you're the sheriff. In the last 12 months, you've really become the sheriff of all things bad in the AFL, major, about image and stuff. And I can't remember what he answered to that, but no, Jake's all right. All right at this stage.
And our last short one here, how did this jumper get approval?
That was...
the South Australian jumper.
How's that?
For the Crows. That was pretty brazen, wasn't it?
It was brazen by the Crows and stupid by the AFL. And we've heard that it was a youngster at the AFL approved it. Oh, yeah, black and teal. Oh, red. They don't clash. Yeah, bang.
Right. Well, without knowing what the red jumper actually was.
Well, it was a long time ago.
Yeah, yeah.
State of origin. So if he was 14 at the time, he's, 23 now, he wouldn't have a bloody clue. It was a South Australian. I actually think that the blame goes back on the Adelaide Crows for trying it. I do.
They tried it on, didn't they?
Yeah.
It was an interesting little measure on how Port has grown. There was probably a time where the Crows could have just barreled that through and not many people would have cared. But Port is a powerful club. Now, they have the ear of the rest of the competition. In a way, they didn't have to do anything. Everyone fought the battle on their behalf.
Yeah, they did.
You can't do that.
I know. It was good.
So it was illuminating, I think, in the growth of Port Adelaide. And I'm sure it will give a little edge.
Are you going to the first game over there?
I don't know. I haven't got my roster yet.
Oh, yeah?
Players night, Robbo.
Jordan Lewis.
It's always good to have a new player.
Of course it is.
Jordan Lewis comes in. And Bob Murphy. It's been quite the off-season for both.
We've got right here, he's on a slight angle, but I think he'll slot this through quite easily.
Pump it up a bit more than that if you can.
Hang on, boys, I'm winding her up.
Okay. Call it for us, Ross, if you like.
Yeah, Jack, composure on his right foot, beautiful. Oh, the little kid behind the goals, hope he's all right.
Every time I back Haley, he normally drifts it off out to the right, so I'm tipping he's going to run in, and it's going to be a slight little fade and just miss to the right, I reckon.
Well, that's
the confidence, for the ruckman.
He's gone in the reverse.
He's running in, he's running towards the points, and straight through the middle.
Talk us through it, Ted.
Well, I pumped him up, I said he's a great kick, so that's why he should be in the forward line. Straight through the middle.
Oh, Ted. There you go.
You're a natural, Ted.
We do that on a weekly basis.
What do we got? Slug Ellard. Kerno, possible in the back.
I think you're right.
Just commentate the Carlton players.
Is this for nine, is it?
Nine.
Yep. We'll wait and see here. I think he's worked on his technique a bit. I don't think that's
enough. <out
before. laughs> He hasn't worked on it at all.
Flicks the ball a couple of times. Steady walk in. Starting to pick up a bit of momentum here for the Crows for a big lead. Kicks through the ball. Bang! That's another one for the Crows.
Buick! Oh, he got a pay and a fire.
Nat Cup, you're going to play that.
Yeah.
You've got to let that go.
Yes.
Cometti will be turning his grave here, Nat.
When players turn commentators. Jackson Trengove could call the Newmarket, I reckon, with the style he's got.
Yeah,
we'll take him to Flemington on Saturday. Bob Murphy, welcome back.
Hi, Jared. Hello, Robert.
Hello, Bob.
Jordan Lewis, welcome aboard.
Thanks for having me.
Great to have you here. The summer, it's real life, isn't it, the summer? And you've indulged in real life here. What have you done over the summer?
I spent a bit of time overseas. We had Campbell's Brown wedding in Bali, so it was nice to get away and see some sunshine after... what was a pretty...
Was there a fight at the wedding?
There potentially could have been, but I had to intervene, which was quite nice. But a little bit of time in Bali, then spent most of the time back here in Melbourne. So it was quite nice.
And did you ask a certain question of a certain girl?
I think she's expected it over there. But then I sort of held off, and then I could feel the pressure coming from the externals and decided to do it a couple of weeks ago, which was quite nice.
A big Instagram photo of an engagement. Congratulations.
Well, I didn't want to miss anyone on the text message, so I thought if I just put it out there on social media, you sort of hit the market and, no one can get unhappy with you.
Robbo's added a dog. You've added a daughter.
Yes. Little Delilah.
Little and, shit, yeah, you call
I was going to say, and I still call her Little Delilah. So, we're over the moon to have another little girl in there. In the clan.
When I saw that photo,
that was paparazzi. I was papped.
But you were papped. You were papped by your wife. I thought to myself, why have you got tattoos in those areas? They're a cute looking kid, but there's big and half
from
of them.
Those little.
What are they?
The chewing gum.
I saw you get interviewed and you said, you made your 10% tougher, so you're now 15%. when did you get those tattoos? Because you've sat with us for 4 years and not mentioned
them. I don't take my top off on the show.
Surely does.
And the
show is clearly
maybe Saul is the only one that chilled.
True.
I've had those for a while. I'm hardcore. Right, yeah. Don't let all the handball receives for you.
You've also had the setback.
Yeah.
And this is what every player dreads during the off-season. The elbow, when it happened, what did you fear?
I've hyperextended elbows before and my knee before. And I usually sort of bounce back and it feels okay. This one I knew was, I thought it was pretty bad. It felt a crunch and a pop and thought, oh, I'm in. And all of a sudden thought, elbow reconstruction could be 3 months, 4 months. So it was, jogging off the ground, I thought I was in a fair bit of bother.
Did you feel dizzy at the time?
I felt nauseous. Off the ground, felt pretty nauseous. And as I got halfway off, I had a 2-week-old baby at the time. I thought, this is not going to be popular. This is a disaster.
So
for the home.
When you rang Justine, about it?
When I got someone to ring Justine.
Right, so you didn't make the phone call?
No, I didn't make the phone call. Yeah, maybe I'm not as hardcore as I thought. She was a bit upset, but yeah, it's all worked out pretty well. I've avoided the surgeon and it might be okay.
What was the difference there? Because I read the story and they said, you've avoided the surgery, that's great. What was the difference between having surgery? How long would you have been out for compared to what you will be out for?
I'm not exactly sure. Surgeons are always pretty confident that, it wouldn't be too long and they were sort of talking, 6 weeks.
But
I was thinking if I had had the surgery, it had to be... Had to be 8 to 10 or maybe even more.
So when you're looking to be, what are you doing? You're running?
I'm running and
marking.
I'm skill training and so we tape it up and I've been doing the skill stuff and I'm confident that I'll be a chance for round one.
That's for show. You don't need that big of a thing on it.
Robo Bob.
Yep. You could do Robo Bob. You're tough enough. You've got the tats.
Thanks. Like
but why have you got that
different
big
tone this year?
You do look a little bit toned. Have you been away as well?
No. Homegrown, mate.
Anyway. So, Jordan, what's the, when you're working through the preseason and you know across the competition a certain number of players will get injuries, and we were speaking about Nathan Vardy last night and the heartbreak of that, does it, is there a fear that, God, if it all goes wrong here, who knows?
I think there's always that element of fear, whether you walk out your door and you step on a stone somewhere and you might roll your ankle, or you know, we do a fair bit of match play in pre-season, so it does increase that risk of injury, but you try and control everything, you know, in terms of tackling, in terms of bumping, guys going back with the flight of the ball, you've got to be really cautious of that. So we've been pretty fortunate, touch wood, we haven't had a major injury in training for a while now, and it is disappointing to see, you know, the likes of Vardy to go down with an injury in training.
There's been a lot this year, hasn't there?
Yeah, there has. Yeah. When you heard of Vardy, I don't know if you know Vardy or not, but you know his story. I know you're really super competitive. Do you have time to feel for him and think, oh, you poor bugger?
Yeah, I think you've got to. I think because we've had a few knees at our club, and we've understood how hard it is to work back from that injury. And, you know, Max Bailey had three knee reconstructions, so he's obviously...
White cross suckling, shoemakers.
Most guys get... I think we sort of accept that you'll get, you know, a big injury in your career. When you see guys get... The follow-up ones, I think everyone, you think, that's rough.
Scott Gumbleton.
Really, Scott Gumbleton. I don't know Scott Gumbleton, but I was just sort of like, oh, that's rough. That's really...
You just like, it's like Xavier Ellis. He's had niggling injuries, not huge ones, but you finally see him get a good run at it over the pre-season. You wish them well, yeah.
So, to think about another player in another circumstance, and you talk about stepping outside onto a stone, what about, say, Zach Clark, who goes to a music festival and gets an injured knee, and there are two potential people to ring, and one is Ross Lyon. That's, couldn't ring Justine.
You're not ringing Ross Lyon.
How would you go ringing Ross Lyon?
I know, from time at the Bulldogs, Chris Bond really well, and I was thinking, oh, it's like they're the options to ring Ross or Bondi. I thought, that is just a terrible...
Who would you have taken?
Oh, I would have got someone else to do it again.
Call the physio.
Yeah.
Delegation.
Yeah,
I like
that's
it.
Right.
Tell me this, Jordan, how long does the Premiership glow last?
Not long. We basically played in the grand final, won it, and then the following week was all about celebrating. I think it's important to have time to celebrate, and then you go away and you enjoy the off-season with family and friends and teammates, but it doesn't last long because as soon as you come back, the competition moves so fast, you can't afford it. And we probably had the luxury in 2008 to really enjoy it, but we probably enjoyed it for too long. So
you pinned the ears back in 2008, didn't you?
Yeah, we did. And there was a lot of other factors that went into why 2009 was such a disappointing season, but we've learned our lesson.
Can I interrupt there? I've spoken to a player, a captain from another club, who have watched you guys play, and I was down in Launceston and watched you, the Hawks play North Melbourne, and he said, I reckon they came back a bit soft in 2009, but they've come back hard in 2014. Do you feel that?
It's hard to compare the 2 years because I was only a little boy back then. And But I think in terms of hard, I think mentally hardened, with living that experience in 2009. And we're very conscious, you know, you always speak about hindsight. We've lived it and we don't want to repeat that. So it's very important to come back with the right attitude. We had a longer break this year than we've had in the past. So that was pretty important that we came back and set our benchmarks and everyone achieved those.
How many times do you think you'll be asked about Buddy Franklin this year by myself, Jared or Bob?
Hopefully not too many because he's not on my side anymore. So he's an opposition player. So
You've got to talk about opposition players too.
Yeah, he's a great...
Cash. Yeah. Bob earns his cash. Talks about all players.
Yeah, he's a great mate of mine. And, he served the Hawthorn Football Club for a good 9 years. And
served it very, very well.
He's still a phenomenal player. And to get that kind of deal thrown at you, I don't think anyone in this room would deny that.
Were you when the Swans are on sale, are you a big watcher of footy? Do you watch other games?
I go through phases. Yeah, I don't mind watching a really good game.
Yep.
yeah, I do tune in. But
Will you watch Buddy a lot this year, you mate?
Yeah, I think so. Because they're such a good side, you want to see what the good sides are doing. So naturally, you watch them, and he's another high.
He's still doing that, bud, isn't he? He did that last year. He's done that for a lot of years.
I think Xavier saw him coming, so he knew what to do.
So part of players gone, players come. So Stuart Cramery's come to the Bulldogs. Who's a player you would have observed, but I presume not known.
Yep.
What's the dynamic like? How long does it take to sort of work into the fold? And he's come with a very specific role, so he will be relied upon and demanded right from the start.
Yeah, it doesn't take long, Jared. We're a pretty basic bunch.
Pragmatic?
We're sort of like, yeah.
Caveman.
Yeah, we've got the colours. You're one of us. We're not for you. We're getting the colours on you. You're one of us.
Well, he's one of us already. He's been here for three minutes.
Yeah, so, he's, you know, we've welcomed him in. He's, you know, part of the family now, and he's down there to play a role for us, and I'm sure he'll do it, you know, with aplomb.
He's got a situation now beyond his control going on with the ASADA investigations and what's happened there. So,
look
just
at that.
How aware are you of the struggles he's got that backdate rather than necessarily the moment that he's in now?
No, not a lot yet. Not a lot yet. I haven't delved into that with him, and maybe that'll happen down the track, but I'm sure he's got lots of, you know, people, confidence that, you know, he would have had around him, and, you know, he's probably sick to death of talking to it. Often, you know, the best support is just to keep it light.
He's come in and you finished the season last year really well, 4 of 6. People can say it doesn't mean anything, you weren't in finals, but we know differently. Picking up Cramery, the McRae, was it Horvat? How do you pronounce his name?
Rovat.
Why did I say Horvat? Because it's a silent H. Who else? Mitch Wallace has improved. Cooney's back with his knee. Just very quickly, the confidence, is it grown, or is it, you know, we're stronger, we're better, we're quicker, we're older?
Yeah, I think we're improving. It feels like we're improving. It felt like the second half of last year. This summer, it feels again like we've improved, and guys, you know, boys are becoming men, but they've improved, you know. The other sides will improve until you get into the real staff, as we'll see in the next few weeks. You really don't know.
Did you feel, look, watching Hawthorne was to go, gee, they took those two games as real tune-ups. Did you get what you wanted to as a team out of those games?
Yeah, I think so. I think every side goes into the NAB Cup with their own agenda. We really just wanted to get minutes into our legs, and the result really didn't matter. There's no grand final or anything like that, and we achieved that. We've got one more game this weekend. Touch wood again, we haven't had too many injuries, so you hope you get through this phase of the pre-season fit, healthy, ready to take the season proper.
At the same time, I don't really care about the Brisbane game because the opposition was young. North Melbourne had a pretty good lineup out there, and you're aware of that. I saw this game. The pressure that you guys put on, Jordan, the pressure you put on for a pre-season game had, I reckon, the rest of the competition going, poof, this is strong and this is early. It's as like, right, this campaign's already begun and we're going at 95% from the start.
Yeah, we haven't spoken about it, to be honest. I think if you approach a game and you try and set a level that you want to achieve, if you go at 60%, you're probably going to get injured and you probably don't want the thing. So you've really got to attack the game like it is an in-season game, just hoping that nothing actually happens to your body. But those Brisbane, they were a little bit depleted, so they had a different agenda than we had. But we've only got 3 games over the whole of pre-season to really get match hardened. And we play Melbourne this week, and then we've got 2 weeks off, and then it's the season. So we probably didn't have an opportunity to rest too many players. Like, every player that was fit, we played, and it worked out that way.
You know how you used to hate playing on Cyril, and you were playing halfback flank, and he was playing small forward. You're now going to the half forward line, and Cyril's gone to the halfback flank. So you're still going to be playing on Cyril.
Did you? Where is he?
He should have
wake up in the middle of the night. Where is he?
He's a backman now. You're chasing him going that way. Where will he play? Quickly, can you tell us or not? Will it be back flank?
I think if you speak to him, he wants to play back. He goes, yeah, good Zish. You don't have an opponent actually sitting on you. I said, if you play consistently, even two games at half back, I reckon you'll get someone with a hard tag.
Yeah, no doubt.
He's one of those players you wish you had 20 of them.
Mm. Well, we can go straight to a rascal. Because there was a standout summer rascal. A very in-house. And we're really looking for the identity, are we not?
We are. And we had our first investigation last year. Mm-hmm. We almost brought down an AFL football club. But, so the one this year is, we don't know really, but we'd like to know. For Valentine's Day, a very touching tribute to our fallen family member, Brad Saul.
He's our stepbrother now.
So yeah, that's right.
He's our stepbrother.
Once removed.
Who does that sort of stuff?
I don't know.
Well, we sort of want to know, don't we?
Well, I tried to find out and I tried to do some digging today, but they came up with nothing. I think it may have been a fan, a supporter, and just expressing their love.
A male or female?
I would imagine a male.
Rest assured, we'll find out. Yeah. We will get to the bottom of this.
He's a pretty good looking bloke, Brad Saul, isn't he?
He'd have a few suitors, wouldn't he?
I saw him with a couple.
Righto. Nice to have you back.
Thanks, boys.
Great to have you as part of Jordan.
Thanks, right on, Jordy.
Okay, that countdown to the football season that Jordan mentioned, it is very much on. And just to think about what's in prospect in a couple of weeks' time, it's occupying the minds of coaches and players, fans and commentators alike.
Cobwebs out.
Just watch this. Oh, no. Just going to suck him in for a while and wait for it to go away.
I think I've ever seen that before. Nobody at all ready for the ball up.
Going to go around the corner here. That's amazing. That is amazing. And that is also ridiculous. Almost hit.
Missed it. Oh, there he is. That's not a big tough Cam Mooney, is it?
Yeah. Look, I'm not happy right now, Hutto. Put it that way. I'm really not happy. Oh, Ty Vickery, that's nasty. He was good last week against the Tigers. Too early, Jared, too early. That was an early Moz, wasn't it? And Edwards kicks the goal on him. Jared, here. What are you doing?
You're bagging him in, Jase?
Have to.
Little doubt.
Oh. Oh, Lord. Thompson. Oh, he fumbled that to Ellard. That wasn't part of the plan.
It goes into the can you believe it foul.
Having a laugh about it. That's how good they're going.
The fun and games and practice as well. Everybody's tuning up. Robbo, we're on the Hungry Jacks 360 seconds clock here to get through as much as we can from the NAB Challenge. So 18 games in 18 days. Did you like it?
Yes. Mm. You?
Yeah, I did.
Righto,
it was
next
the perfect
question.
Taste. Oh. We'll run the clock right down. It was the perfect taste without pretending to be anything more than it was. But my thing is there shouldn't be games this weekend. If there are going to be 18 practice matches, that's it. Play as many intra-clubs as you like. But yeah, don't have an extra set
of
games.
Don't have an extra game. I liked it because there's just so much rubbish on TV that you flick over and then there's a game of footy. And you think, this is great. And you've got to pick your super coach too, mate. Mm-hmm. It's very, very important.
We'll get there shortly. The NAB Challenge highlight for you.
To me, it really was the Hot Hawks. There's a lot to like. Melbourne, we can talk about them later. Again, I missed most of the Brisbane game. I saw some. I turned over and I said, this is a hidey. I'm not watching a shellacking. So, but I was down here for this and I was amazed at how ruthless they were and how hard they were. And The Kangaroos coach, Brett Scott, he lamented after the game that we were quite disappointed at the fact they couldn't get their hands on the ball. And they're considered a reasonably rugged team. I think the Kangaroos have to get harder and tougher if they want to go where they are. But the Hawks are. They're unsociable, and they have been for 8 years. They just denied the Kangaroos the ball.
Yep.
They got it, they won it, and I thought to myself, God, this is March. This is February.
Yep.
This is ridiculous. What was your highlight?
The Giants' big win.
It was massive.
That sort of did it for me. Yeah. And don't worry about the opposition. Just the reinforcement of all the work that's been done across the summer, and also the amusement of kicking 7 super goals.
Yeah, that was nice. That was nice.
I know the wind was blowing.
They look like men, mate. They look like men. They've grown up.
That has to be good for them.
Yep.
A low light.
It was a toss-up for me between Vardy and Gumbleton.
Yep.
I went Gumbleton because this fella was taken, I think, number 2. He's got talent and his body just doesn't not allow him to play football. He has been training for 5 months. That's sprints, Jared. That's long distance running. That's weights. That's legs weights. It's everything. And he lasts one quarter in a game of football. Something's just not right with his body. And I think, and as Bob and Louis said, they felt really, really bad for a young man who, it would appear that this game's beyond him. Yours?
George Burberry. This was as graphic an injury as you see, the broken jaw. And he was playing so well, but that was quite a horrifying sight.
Yeah, it was.
And then the X-ray that he tweeted the next couple of days. Oh, that was grim.
And people reckon, I'll say it, the first time I'm going to say it 100 times this year, and people reckon this game's soft. Yeah. Ridiculous.
Supercoach Smokey, which you alluded to.
Oh, Jack McRae.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the Bulldogs. He's gone 103, 126 in the two games. He's a ripper. They're getting a midfield out there, I'm telling you. Tom Liberatore, he's already there. Mitch Wallace, Cooney's back. Cooney did some great things, McRae. Rovat, I was only joking before on Horvat. Rovat, what was your highlight? What's your Supercoach movie?
Jared Pollock,
yeah.
The way that he fitted in at Port Adelaide. You tweeted, didn't you?
Yeah,
he just went into 230 Supercoach teams.
Yeah,
230,000.
No,
he's going into mine.
Yeah.
He looked like the...
Really good
the
commentary
perfect
there.
Player for him.
Yeah, really good commentary there. Dermot said it. This is the kick. Why they've brought him to the club.
Yep.
Their kick going into the midfield. Not that I concentrate on footy too much, but I'm actually remembering of the commentary of Pollack. He moves really well. He's got a big tank. And I think Brisbane Lions supporters saw a player that they hoped was going to be their club for 10 years.
Best pickup?
Over the summer?
From the NAB Challenge.
Jesse White, for me. Jesse White.
Mm-hmm.
He will be the second ruck. everyone knows, I'll say it. The guy's athletic. You know, if they decide to play Reed down there, if they do, and they go the three tours, and they go White, Cloak, Reed, God help the opposition trying to knuckle those three down, but will they be too heavy? I reckon the Collingwood, how they set up is one of the more intriguing things, and we'll have to wait to round one, but Jesse White has shown that he's going to be a hell of a pickup.
Yep.
What's yours?
Eddie Betts. He's a good player. We all know he's a good player.
Oh, he's better than a good player. Yeah.
He looked very natural in what they're going to set up, and you can picture that with Taylor Walker and James Podziadis.
Can I ask you a question? How much do you think swapping clubs for a guy of Eddie's age, or any age, how much of a motivation is that? How much is a prick in the arm to say, right, let's go?
Significant. It has to be. But I also think that setup is going to suit him better than the setup he was playing in at Carlton, where too often he was the player on the end of the long kick.
He can scrounge.
Yeah. Best access, because it was a television spectacle.
I really liked that.
Good stuff, yeah.
People were critical of it. I thought that was ridiculous. It was fantastic listening to all those people. I thought Juddy was fantastic. And I'll tell you why, because he was sitting there and he sat down. He actually disagreed. Dwayne said something. He said, no, I disagree with that. I think it was Dwayne. If it's not, I apologise. But he's talking about stoppage setups. Now, the people in the box and people writing about us talking about it can say, we think this is what's going on. When you got a guy in the box saying, right, that didn't happen or that should happen, I thought it was just fantastic. Mm. And for the young people or all people looking at it, I just wanted to go down, get a stop and say, right, Juddy, tell me who was in the wrong spots. Yeah. Where should people have been?
Yeah. Andrew Swallow did a great job. He took the cameras down into the North Melbourne rooms. He interviewed the coach. He got right into the spirit of it. And these are practice matches. It's, I thought he handled it beautifully and, you know, he's on the long wait. We got through 6, we had a few more. But
just very quickly, how good's footy
when AFL clubs allow that sort of access.
Yeah, and it's there is for the fans, isn't it? Yeah, Special 360 tomorrow night. The AFL launch is in Adelaide. You'll be there, Robbo. I'll be here with Mike Sheehan, and we will bring you the feature parts of the night, including the speech from Andrew Demetriou and Hawthorne's collection of the flag.
Stanley, big deep kick. A big high ball into the 50. Day flew. Oh, all sorts of pressure for the Bombers.
Knocked out that time by Heppel, but Ablett's got it. He's just outside the 50. Gary Ablett tries to do something extraordinary. It's across the face, but it's a score.
7 seconds. Ablett, have a shot, getter. He does, and you know what? He has kicked a point.
Is it?
It's a winner.
It's a win.
It's a winner.
Well, I actually thought the siren went as I got the ball handballed to me. So anyway, got the point, got the win. Stoked.
It was a good finish.
I've missed his four-way drop punts that go 58 metres.
Yeah.
Did you see the connection?
It didn't go through. Yeah, at all.
I know. The connection was unbelievable.
Yep. Yep.
God, I can't wait to see Gazza play again. You missed the guns, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. So tomorrow night you'll be in Adelaide. We're going to speak with Ken Hinckley and Brenton Sanderson. It's all happening at the Adelaide Oval, which there's such excitement around. There's a Shield game on at
Can
the
I get
time.
On early?
Can you get on it early? Did you
say? No, can I get on early?
So tell me, when you go home tonight to Tiger, what's the routine?
I let him in, he jumps all over me, and I call him a little shit and kick him back out of the house.
Could you not do that?
Swear or kick
him? That's enough.
I feed him, pat him, and then I'll start worrying about what I'm going to talk about tomorrow night.
Talk to you then. See you then.
This has been a Fox Footy production for Fox Sports.